Welcome back, geology fans. We ended last episode with a primary sedimentary structure of graded bedding, made by high-energy flows suddenly ending. We continue this week with more primary sedimentary structures, and we'll start with more features made by high-energy flow. Such violent flows, while in motion, tend to scour the bottom of the waterway. Various features get preserved in this case, especially if the bottom sediment is made of mud. Flowing water can drag sticks and logs along muddy stream bottoms to make impact and scrapes we call tool marks. We can often infer flow direction from such features, but in many cases, not in the original bed they were made in. Because these tool marks are most easily carved out in clay and mud, and because mud erodes more easily than most any other material, these impact and scrape marks often show up as casts on the bottom of the overlying bed. We speak of the original indentations in this case as the molds, and the material deposited into the indentations preserving the forms as casts. Scrapes into the mud surface thus often appear as linear ridges out of the bottom of material, often sandstone, that filled in those scrapes. The same is true of flute casts, which form from violent flow over fine-grained sediment. The fast water gouges into the muddy bottom, making a deep pit mold on top side that flumes outward and shallower downstream, which we are seeing in cast form sticking out of the bottom of the overlying bed. All these features, which are called sole markings, give you both up direction and flow direction. If the high-energy event drops larger clastic material with strong unidirectional flow, that is, one direction of flow, we can get a sedimentary structure called imbrication. Any clasts with a tabular, flattened appearance tend to deposit on-lapping the clast downstream from them, which in the end gives a shingled appearance to the deposit, where the clasts lean in the same direction and overlap each other. Imbrication can give you the primary flow direction that deposited the material. With lower consistent energy levels, we see bed forms, patterns on the bed of the stream, such as ripples, which particularly form in sandy material. Wind and water will make dunes and ripples made of clastic materials. There are two main flow patterns, unidirectional, one direction of flow, typical of wind or streams, and bidirectional, or oscillatory flow, which goes back and forth, such as waves on a beach. Starting with medium energy, unidirectional flow, the bedload material, whether driven by water or wind, bounces along a relatively low slope up to the top of the dune or ripple on the windward side or stoss side, and then tumbles down the downwind or lee face, which has a steeper, curvilinear form. The result at various scales are ripples. Ripples tend to have sharper ridges, which we call crests, than valleys, which we call troughs, and so you can tell if the ripple is a mold on the top of the originally rippled bed with sharp crests, or a cast on an overlying bed with sharp troughs. But ripples not only tell us up direction, but original direction of flow, and if it is unidirectional or if it's bidirectional flow, that is, did the wind or water flow in only one direction or oscillate back or forth. Unidirectional flow makes these asymmetrical dunes and ripples with a lee and stoss side. Ripples at the beach don't have a stoss side and a lee side, as the flow equally goes back and forth. The beach ripples that result are symmetrical, though they typically also have sharper ridges. This sandstone from southeast Iowa tells me of a time where there was a beach there. And these symmetrical ripples tell me of when my area near Denver was a beachfront property. Now, unidirectional flow does create an upwind or stoss side of the ripple or dune, which is lower in slope, leading to a downwind or lee side of the ripple or dune, which has a steeper face, which cups in the direction of flow. The lee face is concave to the direction of flow. So we can tell from the shape of an asymmetrical ripple or dune which way the water or wind was flowing, from the low slope side to the steep slope side. But take a moment to imagine what would happen if there were a periodic pulse of energy or cementing material into this ripple system. With ripples and dunes having material added to their downwind, or lee face, that face is constantly getting buried and migrating downflow. Should a morning dew help cement the lee face, higher wind deposit coarser material in the afternoons, or occasional pulses of water with storms and melt events? we can form one of the more beautiful up and flow direction indicators, crossbedding. Crossbedding is just what the name implies. Bedding features in a sedimentary rock that go across the principal bedding plane. As dunes and ripples override their predecessors, whole crossbedded sets can accumulate into beautiful information bombs. Here at Dinosaur Ridge near Golden, Colorado, we see the relationship of ripples on top of the bed to the crossbeds within it. Updirection is told from the fact that the crossbeds come up to a sharper contact with their overlying bed and blend into the original bedding surface at a very low angle at their base. Later we will talk about taking measurements of attitude of beds, and obviously a crossbed surface is not a bedding plane and shouldn't be confused as such. These crossbeds intersect that original bedding plane surface in the direction of flow, or we can say the crossbeds are concave in the direction of flow that deposited them. Checkerboard Mesa in Zion National Park, Utah, tells the story of wind-blown dunes hundreds of millions of years ago, and that these original bedding surfaces were slightly tilted from their original horizontal position, but not overturned. But wait, there's more! With these crossbeds, you also get the predominant wind direction, which here is left to right, except for that short time there where it blew the other direction. And so I know the dominant wind direction in the middle of Utah during the Age of Dinosaurs. And these are information bombs. And we also know the tides went in and the tides went out back then, because we have rhythmic sedimentary sequences that show such repeated cycles of depositional environments. If spring tides and neap tides are causing the rhythms we see in the sediment, we call such rhythmic deposits tidal bundles. If seasonal cycles of freeze and thaw or annual monsoonal cycles switch between depositional materials in a lake, we call them varves. The Castile Formation on the Texas-New Mexico border varies between dark calcite deposition during more humid seasons and anhydrite layers during the dry seasons. Thus, each couplet makes an annual pair, resulting in this bimodal rhythmic layering. The stalagmites I modeled in my PhD have an annual deposition cycle of decomposed organic acids every spring, which shows up as these fluorescent bands under a laser confocal microscope. Cyclical rise and fall of global sea level can produce rhythmic large-scale patterns, whereas tidal bundles are smaller scale. But because both occur at shorelines, we may also see evidence of organisms burrowing through the sediment or evaporites precipitating and dissolving out, but such changes only take place after the sediment is deposited, and thus fall into a different category, the secondary sedimentary structures, which are the stars of our next episode, here on Earth Explorations.